U.S. President Joe Biden issuing a statement following his son's guilty verdict. Biden says he accepts the outcome of the case and would respect the judicial process as his son considers an appeal. Biden has previously said he would not pardon Hunter if convicted. Hours after the verdict, Biden showcased his administration's effort to cut down on illegal gun trafficking and reduce crime at a gun violence prevention summit. But he made no mention of his son's case.
The only industry in America that has immunity are gun dealers.
We got to end it. End it now.
It's time to increase funding for the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms and Explosives and other law enforcement agencies as well.
To solve the crimes faster, we got to stop it. We got to stop it and stop it now. More children are killed in America by guns than cancer and car accidents combined.
Democrats largely favor stricter gun laws as a way of to reduce deaths from gun violence in schools and in cities across the U.S. Republicans, meanwhile, oppose tougher regulations. U.S. President Joe Biden's son, Hunter Biden, found guilty of lying about his drug use to illegally purchase a gun. The jury found Hunter guilty on all three counts, making him the first child of a sitting U.S. president to be convicted of a crime. A verdict of the 12-member jury must be unanimous on each count. Sentencing guidelines for the charges are 15 to 21 months, but legal experts say defendants in similar cases often get shorter sentences.
While there has been much testimony about the defendant's abuse of drugs and alcohol, ultimately this case was not just about addiction. A disease that haunts families across the United States, including Hunter Biden's family. This case was about the illegal choices defendant made while in the throes of addiction. No one in this country is above the law. Everyone must be accountable for their actions, even this defendant. However, Hunter Biden should be no more accountable than any other citizen convicted of this same conduct. The prosecution has been and will continue to be committed to this principle.
The trial follows the May 30 criminal conviction of Donald Trump, the first former U.S. president to be found guilty of a felony. The verdict against Hunter gives the Democrats opportunity to counter Trump's claim the justice system is being weaponized against him. The United States seeing hopeful signs from Hamas on its ceasefire proposal. Hamas previously welcomed the UN's resolution backing the plan to end the war in Gaza. A senior official of the Palestinian militant group now saying they are ready to negotiate deals of the truce.
Yesterday, the United Nations Security Council, in effect speaking for the entire international community, made it as clear as it possibly could be that this is what the world is looking for. 14 votes for, no votes against, something quite rare at the Security Council these days, and I think that speaks volumes too. So everyone's vote is in, except for one vote, and that's Hamas.
But for Israel, the Hamas response is tantamount to a rejection. Egypt and Qatar have received the group's response, but did not disclose the content. A Hamas official, however, tells Reuters they reaffirmed their stance, including that the deal must lead to a permanent end to hostilities and the withdrawal of Israeli forces. An Israeli official, meanwhile, says Hamas's answer changed all the main and most meaningful parameters of the deal. The leader of France's Conservative Republicans calls for an alliance with Marine Le Pen's, National Rally in a snap parliamentary election called by President Emmanuel Macron. Le Pen's far-right party is widely expected to emerge as the strongest force, although it may fall short of an absolute majority. The comments by Republican Party leader Eric Ciotti signifies a decades-old consensus in France's political establishment to join forces to keep the far right from power is crumbling. The decision has already sparked anger with protests held in front of the party's headquarters. It could also mean the Republican Party, already a shadow of its former self, is likely to implode. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin with the massive backlog in immigration cases in the United States and how immigrant families are coping. For Filipina Esther Basilisco, this is long overdue celebration with her children in Chicago, Illinois, after being separated from them for over 10 years. The Iloilo native's petition to bring her son and daughter to the U.S. was finally approved in 2021, but the pandemic and backlogs in processing immigration cases caused this delayed reunion.
We wrote two times to the embassy, and the embassy told us you must wait because there are a lot of people who are also prioritizing. So we wait and waited.
According to government data compiled by Syracuse University's Transactional Records Access Clearinghouse, as of April 2024, backlog cases reached over 3.5 million, including 1.3 asylum matters.
Because of the number of people coming to the border, all the resources, the time, and the money has all been focused here, and it's affecting everybody else that's trying to come the legal way through family, through employment, or any other way.
Like all immigration attorneys, Shao says, they're all trying to keep up with all the changes in immigration rules, including the recent executive order by President Joe Biden, which restricts most asylum seekers and allows border officials to quickly turn back migrants who enter the U.S. illegally. Meanwhile, Filipinos on the East Coast took to the streets to celebrate the Philippine Independence Day with a parade, the largest of its kind outside the Philippines. From the indigenous Igorot people of the Cordilleras in northern Philippines to the Cuyamis Festival dancers from Misamis Oriental to New York's finest Filipinos of the NYPD, Filipinos came out in full force for the annual parade on the first Sunday of June.
On behalf of all our Filipino bishops in America, may the Lord bless all of us here.
Filipino people represent the best of America. Hardworking, loving family, caring about education, being respectful of their neighbors, making sure streets are safe, making sure their kids have a better opportunity than they did.
And the winner is Lord Mayor. Aww.
And finally, Pinoy Pride reigned supreme at the James Beard Foundation Awards, regarded as the most prestigious national restaurant awards in America. Lord Maynard Liera, chef of Kuya Lord, won the award for Best Chef in California. This is the Filipino chef's first James Beard Award win and the only award Los Angeles took home for 2024. Liera's Kuya Lord restaurant, which began as a pop-up, is an elevated fast casual restaurant featuring regional Filipino dishes he grew up eating in Lucena City, Quezon Province, Philippines.
This recognition is not just a testament to my individual efforts and hard work, but a reflection of the support and encouragement and collaboration from many wonderful people in my life. I am fortunate enough to have mentors, friends, and family all throughout this journey.
Adding honors for the Filipino community, Abby Balingit, baker and author of the cookbook Mayumu Filipino-American Desserts Remixed, won the James Beard Emerging Voice Award in books.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.